for just 200 or 300 strikes of these. I was just so shocked by it. I actually called Mr. Pelosi and Feinstein. I called everybody and I said, this is the most disgusting, shocking. Are you familiar with the case?
We actually released that video.
Well, that was your Petrov. That's why.
It's a general by the name of Stanislav Petrov. He's Ukrainian.
Right.
I don't know how many of you saw this video, but I got a call from one of my former students who said, hey, check out this video. And so he just sent me a little clip, and I said, oh, because it showed this guy basically running down an alley. You see two cops, tackle him, and then they just start hitting him, with his billy club.
You know, like Rodney King.
And they hit him over 30 times, and you can hear it too. And it's just, you can just hear the billy club, breaking his bones. And we didn't know who he was. All we had was a video. And so we ended up having a press conference and sharing the video. It was on the news, and it turned out that these were elevated sheriffs that chased him down with an alley. And we beat him, we finally got him in the hospital with broken bones. But still, no one was prosecuted. You're right.
Were those police officers not charged in any way?
We turned over to the DA and San Francisco, but nothing happened. And that's why a lot of people were really upset, about the Mario Woods shooting, Alex Nieto, because we're seeing these shootings.
Are they legally allowed to do that?
Well, if it were you and I, that were caught on tape doing something like that, you'd be in jail right now. I mean, no question about it. But there seems to be different rules that apply to police officers, and I think that's what frustrates them.
But they weren't threatened. They weren't. There was no.
Yeah.
I just can't understand how they could be motivated. What was the?
Well, just like the Mario Wood shooting. I don't know if you saw that video. It's a young African American guy. They said he had a knife in his hand. Walking away from the police and they shoot him like 20
times. But how do they justify that? I just don't know how they justify that kind of beating. Yeah.
So the police commission comes to the Tenderloin about once a year. 2 years ago, all the people from Alex, and so it's our chance to kind of give them what our problems are in the Tenderloin. Mm-hmm. But 2 years ago, the Alex Nieto people came in, and we really didn't get that conversation. Mm-hmm. And then just 1 week ago, they were here, just across the street. Yeah. And of course, the Alex Woods people, the Mario Ward lawyers who came in, and once again, we lost our chance. Mm-hmm. I am empathic to the issues in the police department, and it seems like you know a lot about it. Some ideas were going around about how to reform the police department, and if you might share any ideas you might have.
We came out with a 9-point reform plan in 2015. We've been working to implement it. For example, one of the things now, the police department tracked who was being stopped and what nationality they were. Now they're required to do that every quarter. And body cameras is something that I've pushed for a lot of years because it makes the officers safer and makes us safer. As a public, all the studies show that the complaints go way down and excessive force goes way down when they're wearing body cameras. The other things that we're trying to push for is better training in terms of dealing with mentally ill people, right? Because the protocol right now is that hey, if somebody threatens your life, if somebody pulls out a knife, you can shoot them dead. You and I, if we're in that situation with six of our friends and we shot somebody 22 times because they waved a knife at us, we'd be in jail, facing a murder charge, at least a manslaughter charge. And so again, we have to change the culture within the police department because it can't be just because I have the right to shoot you, I can shoot you. And I'm going to shoot you, down, if you have a knife in your hand and you look threatening, I'm going to shoot you 20 times, right? That has to change. I mean, there are other countries, Scotland, in the UK, where, they peaceably take people into custody without shooting them to death if they have a knife. So those kind of things,
there has to be accountability.
They're kicking around the idea of electing the chief of police or possibly the police commissioner both. You got any ideas on that?
Well, right now it's supported by the mayor, and I have to say that chiefs serve, in terms of my relationships and experiences with them, that has been very positive. You can get back to me right away. If there's an issue that comes up, he's not somebody who's mealy mouth and they just tag one thing in doesn't tell the whole story. You know, for them to come out and say, oh, this is justified, they're right off the bat without moving an investigation, I think it makes everybody scratch their head and say, really? Right? And then the district attorney's supposed to be investigating the cops. You know, people don't have confidence in that.
The median tenure of a police chief is like 2, 3, 4 years max in this city. I mean, if it isn't one thing, it's another.
Yeah.
Is it similar to the Eric Garner case and the Michael Brown and all the others where there's been no accountability? It's gone before a grand jury, and of course they sided with the district attorney. Is it kind of similar in every big city or every police department?
Well, I mean, you know, especially when you're talking about the grand jury, California just had a new law passed that said grand jury can't decide police shooting cases, because often what they'd be able to do is to use the grand jury and to present the case in a very weak way.
Right.
That's what happened in Tamir Rice, right? 12-year-old.
Oh, another egregious case in Wisconsin.
The DA told the grand jury, not even to vote, so they never even voted on whether to indict
the officer. They murdered this kid. I mean, I just...
And so, you know, when that sort of thing happens, I mean, I think people lose public confidence in the police, and that's not a good thing.
Okay, Bruce. Go ahead.
I have a slight voiceless problem. I'll speak up. A quick observation.
Yeah.
A question. According to the Guardian, the best newspaper in the world, they're keeping tracks of police murders in the U.S. Roughly, are you ready? 4 per day.
4 per day.
Almost 1,400 police killings last year. Okay, they came up with a really interesting statistic. I'd like to direct to you. You should play it better than anyone else. They say, their statistical analysis, a mentally disturbed or mentally ill person has a 16 times greater probability of being killed. Does that say something about the police training, for example?
Yeah. Yeah, they have something called crisis intervention training, and it's something that's relatively new. Before it wasn't mandatory, so only if officers wanted to take the training, they could. They just started making it mandatory for the new police academy classes, so 2 classes have been trained so far, but it basically teaches officers how to, you know, de-escalate a situation with somebody who's mentally ill. Like one of the questions, like in the Mario Wood situation, obviously he was going through some kind of mental health crisis. You know, when you got 6 people around him, plus 3 other cops right there, you know, you can't distract them. And help and bonk them on the head or do something else rather than, you know, shoot them. And that's the question that's being asked, right? Is that, you know, why is deadly force the first option? And especially if you know you're dealing with somebody who's mentally ill or who's going through a crisis, you know, you've got to be able to take that into consideration. But again, it's a training issue. You know, and I'm sure the officers are going to say, yeah, well, I was afraid, I was scared in that situation. But if you're walking into the path of a person who's, you know, standing there with a knife, you know, there's going to be a confrontation, right? And so it raises questions of how can you de-escalate situations so if a person doesn't, you know, there's a great YouTube that shows in the UK, you know, there's a crazy guy with a big old machete, I don't know if you saw this, running around like a maniac. If anybody, you know, probably shot him, it would be him. But the police, at first, they retreat, and they come back with these big shields, plastic shields, and they take them down.
Aren't they talking about that here as well, the medical thing, or adding them to their arsenal?
Yeah, they just added the shield, the heavy shield.
So, same question in that. Are they going to offer de-escalation training for citizens?
For citizens?
Yeah, I mean, to de-escalate, like you're walking late at night in the tenderloin and confronted with people with a knife, you know.
And in that situation, you're better off running. That's the best way to get you try to talk to somebody, it may not be the smartest thing.
Yeah, so
I have
a couple more questions. Yeah.
I'm just curious to know how you
can
get police officers enhancing the efficacy of our training and our Public defender system is going to help our district. What is a goal or what is one aspect of the vision that you have that will make what's happening to the police, what's happening in your office, what's happening in any sort
really the portal, you know, to really immigrate those three to come to San Francisco. And so, you know, part of what we have to do is make the streets safe. And, you know, clearly there are too many guns, you know, weapons, you know, drugs are a problem. But I really think that drugs are more of a public health issue that we have to really answer with treatment. And so we've done that. We've kind of focused our policies to try to get treatment for individuals to get them out of drugs. That's why we have the Community Justice Center right here in the TL. That's why we provide a lot of direct services here in the Tenderloin to help address those kinds of issues. In terms of violence, I think people expect that when you're dealing with a violent crime, whether you're accused or a victim, that it be taken seriously, that the cases are brought to court quickly, and that does not, you know, that's often that. If somebody is charged with violence, you're going to be represented properly. You don't want the system that's unreliable or something. It's just easy to get convicted of a crime, serious crime, than it would be a minor crime. So we have to work together with the district attorney, the probation, the parole. And so one of the things we have is a reentry counselor. So we actually work with people who are coming out of jail or prison to help them keep their life on track so they don't re-involve themselves in crime. And we've been very successful at doing that.
Last question. So we use the forest policy to the 1990 policy of the 1996 rules. And now the police before were required to report each time they take out the gun and point it at a suspect. And so but the Police Officers Association is showing a lot of resistance towards this. My question is the Police Officers Association seem kind of powerful, don't they?
Yes. Absolutely. I mean, you know, I was just reading how they like ordered the president of the Board of Supervisors so not to support some measure of excessive force and things like that. And, you know, certainly every union, you know, has its role in terms of taking care of the interests of its members. But I think that's, you know, what's been troubling is that, you know, it hasn't really become like this political fight where the focus is not so much on public safety, you know, but this person's right or that person's right. And I do think that we all have to come to the table if we're going to, you know, solve these problems. If people are getting shot and killed in the streets, if, you know, people aren't feeling safe from the crime, if they don't have faith in the police department, if you have racist Texas that came out, in certain areas of the police department comes out and reinstated for different reasons, you know, people are losing confidence in the police. And I don't think the POA wants that. I don't think the CIR wants that. Chief CIR wants that. And I don't think any of us want that. You know, I think we want a police department that is qualified to do the work that they do, and that we can count on. So, again, thank you very much.
Next on the agenda, then.
Yes, Susan's got this.
annual gathering, we mail it out to our entire membership and outreach list. Membership committee was able to attract new members in 2015. ABD6 hosted our 7th annual holiday party in December, inviting community members to celebrate with us and recognize 10 small businesses in the North Market area. In 2006, the executive committee established members-only message board to provide annual benefits to our additional benefits to our members membership. We now have a groups page on Facebook and a new organizational website at www.abd6.org. The membership committee has designed a new membership /outreach form. Copies are in the sign-in tables. We would like to remind all members and guests to sign in at the sign-in table to provide us with your updated contact information and indicate which committees, programs, or topics interest you. Please remember to fill out both sides of the form. Reminder, please keep your membership dues current, please. And we rely on membership dues and donations to cover our administrative and operating expenses. We are a membership-driven organization. Summary, 8 new members total from 2015, 0 new nonprofits, 6 residents, 2 businesses, and 0 property owners. Motion to accept for the members.
I motion.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any abstentions? Any abstentions or no? Okay, motion passes.
Okay, now the treasurer's report. This is the total income for 2015, $4,578. Total expenses for 2015, $5,720.15. Income deficit, we are in the red, $1,142.15. The treasurer recommends to the membership committee to collect uncollected membership dues for 2015 and prior years from the members. Additional recommendations are that the membership committee expands our membership to cover future expenses. We are also looking for volunteers to be part of the fundraising committee. Please see me to sign up. The new 2016 administration of the U.S. will be looking at future fundraising activities to remind our friends and members to kindly show their support. Our donation can, which is being passed around, will now be distributed to cover our administrative and operating expenses. Please give generously. We had someone that was going to give you really good money at Hitch, and he was really good. He would have been really good. He's not here.
I'll do it for the moment. The Alliance has been around, is the resident-based organization that's been around since 1999, and the purpose of it is to do quality of life improvements. We also deal with when new businesses come along, we deal with their permits. When new developers come along, we deal with how they're going to impact our neighborhood. So we deal with land use issues. All these things have changed over the years in our district. We've helped form the various CBDs that are currently involved in the district. We've had our members